welcome to the next episode of Matt's Workshop, episode 2. In the previous episode, I explained and I went through how I was going to convert my Chris Foss Uno Wot from IC power, i.e. engine power, to electric. And I went through how I started up the motor for the first time in 2 years and the engine was running first time. I've now taken the motor out of the aircraft and I was going to do a detailed blow-by-blow step on how I removed it. The problem was, when I explained in episode 1 how well this model had been put together, getting the engine out was a lot easier said than done due to the high standard the model had been built to. As we were setting the equipment up for this evening shoot, which is it's Saturday evening here in the UK, there's an amazing aroma of curry in the workshop. We were setting the equipment up and there's an Indian takeaway come restaurant just down the road from here, and we just couldn't resist nipping down and grabbing a quick and cheeky vindaloo, which we ate in the workshop just before we started. So if you see me sniffing about food during the show, then it is because I'm getting a full waft of the curry smells. Anyway, back to the models. Earlier on, I took the motor out. You can see it is an OS25. Just give you a bit of a close-up on it there. And that was a lot harder to remove than I thought it was. Whoever built the model, I don't know how or what they've used to secure the silencer screws in, but they are really, really tight indeed. And I still haven't worked out how I'm going to remove them. Once I've got the motor out, I'll give it a clean up and I'll put it on eBay. That goes on. That leads on to the next question that I had for myself. What motor do I use to power it with? I had three motors sitting here that have been sitting around for months. I've got a Turnigy Aero Drive, which is one of these. I've got a slightly bigger Formax, slightly smaller Formax motor, which is one of these. You'll see on it, there's that blue weight on the corner of it. That's used to balance the motor. These Formax motors are really, really high quality indeed. I've got a few of them. They're great, but really, really good and reliable. The third motor I had, and this is a motor I decided to go with, is another Formax, which I mounted down the front, which you can see here. There's the official conversion chart on the Chris Foss website, which says how you can make up a plywood mount for your electric motor. I just decided to go for an off-the-shelf aluminium motor, which I've had to fettle down, and it's now ready for its trial fit. It's sitting in there now. The motor on the mount, you can slide forward and backwards because the original cowl sits on the front of the motor here, and it's going to require a bit more fettling and a bit more position before it's finished. I've got a nice new fiberglass cowl on the way, which I'll fit as soon as it arrives. But in the meantime, the fact that this has been cut away to allow the engine to fit is really, really good for me to align it up and get everything nice and perfect. In another episode, I'll talk through how I'm going to go through the decals on the motor. I've taken all the rear decals off the rear fin. There's now a white tail. I might take these stripes off, I might not, depending on how the rest of it cleans up. I've left the windows on for now because I'm going to reprint the windows, but that will be to a completely different design, which will look really, really smart indeed. Literally just waiting for a courier to come along tomorrow with all the bits in the bag. Finally, I've got an electronic speed controller in there. This is a Turnigy Plush 40 amp, which is ideal for an application like this, and it will go in nicely. Let's just have a quick run through the sequence of how I took the engine out earlier on. It looks as if I got it out in under 2 minutes, but in reality it was a lot longer than that, and I nearly skinned my knuckles a couple of times. We'll be right back. So that's got the engine out. Believe me, it wasn't as easy as it looks in that video. Yeah, there was a lot of gnashing of teeth and sweating as I was doing it. I've also taken the undercarriage off because that makes the model easier to work on when it's on the bench. I was quite pleased when I took the undercarriage off because I found out that it had been fitted using plastic bolts. That's an example of one of the bolts that came off. A lot of people may say to me, "Why do you use plastic bolts on your undercarriages?" The reason for that is relatively straightforward. As you come into land, the model can be coming down from as you come in on your final approach, you've got to go bang, and you will land it quite hard. There's a danger that you can rip, if you're using metal bolts, there's a danger that you can rip the undercarriage off, which will do a lot of damage to the floor pan. Oops, shouldn't have happened. Changing the floor pan is about an afternoon's work because you've got to cut the panel out, fabricate another one up in balsa, fit it back in with epoxy and glue, then recover it, and it's not a pleasant task to do. If you use a plastic bolt and you come in too hard, all that happens is you'll just shear the bolt off. These bolts are about like 5p each. You can get them down in places like Halfords or at any motor factors. 5 minutes later, unscrew the bolt, put the new one back in, and you're off ready to go flying again. Looking into the, I've said all along that this model's been built to a very, very high standard indeed. Let's just have a quick look in the engine compartment. There's virtually no signs of fuel ingress in there at all. There's a little bit of fuel standing on the front. So when the model was built, whoever built it put a good application of fuel preservative in there and fuel proofer. I always say apply fuel proofer liberally if you're building an IC model. I know one guy who I gave some advice to who took that to heart, and he'd literally caked the entire inside of the model with fuel proofer to the extent that the top canopy it then glued itself to the top of the model. We had a devil's own job one Sunday afternoon trying to separate it. I'll just take the camera off the tripod now and I'll give you some close-up views of inside the engine bay. So there you can see the 4MAX motor mounted in the frames. It's going to need a little bit more shoehorning before it's finished, but that gives you a rough idea of how it's gone in so far. This is an off-the-shelf mount that I had to attack with a hacksaw to make it fit. You've got the three wires coming out the brushless motor. I'll shortly have to drill a hole in the front bulkhead to make them fit. This is the inside of the engine bay. We've still got the four studs from where the original IC engine mount was going in there. Again, there's a lot of epoxy in there, so that's held together. There's no sign of that's going to be pulling apart. Moving into the cabin aft, all the electronics have gone. There's a gaping hole where the throttle servo used to be, and we've got the elevator and the rudder servo still in there. We've also got, as you can see, one of the advantages of using an off-the-shelf motor mount rather than fabricating one. With all those different holes, there's room for almost infinite levels of adjustment in there. If the motor that I've decided to fit to this model does turn out to be underpowered, I can easily put another motor on there and adjust it up relatively quickly rather than having to fabricate a completely new motor mount. Let's just have a quick talk about the different motors I considered and why I went for the option I did. Let's have a look at the different types of electric motor available to power the Chris Foss Uno Wot. The recommended motor is the AXE 282010, and the equivalent by 4MAX is the PO3541-1270. It puts out 1270 kilovolts, it's got a diameter of 35mm, it's 41mm long, shaft diameter of 5mm, shaft length 20mm, 127 grams weight, M3 holes with a pitch of 25mm, with a 4mm max mounting depth, and the number of poles and the number of amps are roughly the same across the board. My favoured motor, I think, is going to be the PO2834-1020. I've got one of these sitting on the bench, it's ready to go. I've also got the Turnergy D3548, which is quite a heavy motor for this type of application. My chosen motor, the PO2834-1020, weighs in at 69 grams, so I reckon that we may have to put some ballast in up front to get the centre of gravity correct. If this motor turns out to be underpowered, then it's relatively straightforward to put in either the Turnergy or the other motor I have in my toolbox, which is the PO3547-1190. Hopefully you found the inside of the engine bay and the tour of the inside of the model, now the electronics and the engine have been removed, useful. I think that's about it for this episode. Any questions, please do ask away, comment, etc. I'll see you on the next episode, which should be out soon. Ta-da for now. Bye-bye.